Saludos a todos, que lo que es. Peace to all. This is your brother David Rodriguez with another episode of Hispaniola History Channel in the continuing series of the other slavery of Hispaniola. This one is called the Lucayans, Casualties of War. This tribe, who were they? What were their contributions? What were their interactions with the first Europeans to arrive in Hispaniola? And how this information may impact Dominicans today. This is the Hispaniola History Channel. We're featuring the Lucayans. This is the Hispaniola History Channel, La Historia de Hispaniola, presented by David Rodriguez. So as covered on the last episode, at the point where the population of the island started to decline due to slavery, disease, war, and also being shipped out into Spain. But according to the records and what we covered, the immediate solution was to go to the surrounding islands, to go to Puerto Rico, Jamaica, Cuba, South America. And one of those locations was also the Bahamas. Some expeditions were leaving from the north coast of Hispaniola, also the north coast of Puerto Rico were some expeditions as well. The Lucayans and their interactions with the Europeans have been well documented by the scholars and early historians. So who were the Lucayans? Here getting some information from this book, The Story of the Bahamas by Paul Aubrey. Here's some information provided from that source. Columbus thought that the Lucayans resembled the Gauchi of the Canary Islands, in part because they were intermediate in skin color between European and Africans. He described the Lucayans as handsome, graceful, well-proportioned, gentle, generous, and peaceful. Peter Martyr said that the Lucayan women were so beautiful that the men from other countries moved to the islands to be near them. Women past puberty wore a small skirt of cotton, and the men might wear a loincloth made of plaited leaves or cotton. Some people wore headbands, wristbands, and feathers. So, you know, we got early accounts of certain tribes roaming around naked, but this particular tribe, these particular people, the Lucayans, were clothed, and were clothed with cotton, and some had headbands, wristbands, and feathers. It's interesting. I'm here at this book, Old Panama, Castillas de Oro, by Dr. C.L.G. Anderson. I'm on pages 50 and 51, in which it documents the interaction between Columbus and the Lucayans. It says, the aboriginal people of the Bahamas, the Lucayans, discovered by Columbus, were a tall, graceful, dark-skinned race of barbarians. They were gentle and loving, quite unlike their cousins of the mainland, or their fierce neighbors to the south, the Caribs, who dealt in the Lesser Antilles. They possessed pottery and stone implements like the Celts. So we have a people here who are kind of set apart from the rest of the quote-unquote Caribs of the Lesser Antilles. These are people who Columbus are comparing to the Celts, Celtics. Here I have a source, The Early Spanish Main by Carl Sawyer, from pages 56 to 61. He explains how the Lucayans grew cotton and tobacco and used other plants, including agave, ficrea, and hibiscus for fiber and fishing nets. One of Columbus' sailors received 12 kilograms of cotton in trade from a single Lucayan. So already Columbus's peoples were trading early with the Lucayans. There was a cotton trade very early. I'm here at the book, The People Who Discovered Columbus, The Prehistory of the Bahamas, William F. Keegan. He provides some information in page 91, alluding to the Lucayan Society. Lucayan Society was based on descent through the mother's line. So that's a matriarchal system. Caonabo, the king of the island when Columbus first arrived, was originally of Lucayan lineage. There's accounts where some of the people on the tribe of the Lucayan tribe were trading cotton with Columbus. The king of the island at the time Columbus arrived was of Lucayan lineage. And let's not forget that he was the husband of the queen, Ana Caona. She was the queen of the island. So if they operated under a matriarchal system, that means the person who was really running things was Ana Caona. Caonabo was there to defend not only her but the island, and that was his role. So we know once the interactions began between Columbus and Caonabo, it was not a friendly one. It was a war that took place. But we also know that it was unclear whether or not there was a partnership with the Tagayos. But both tribes were similar since both were involved in cultivating cotton and tobacco before the arrival of Europeans. While also both the Lucayans and the Tagayos opposed and fought against Columbus and his regime. As we know what came after in that blist of that second voyage from Columbus, where he came with reinforcements and a bigger fleet of ships and soldiers. This is when the war took place. The king of the island, Caonabo, was taken out, taken prisoner. What comes after, of course, is slavery, captives of war. Pulling from this reference here, the Surviving the Spanish Conquest from Karen Anderson Cordova. I'm reading from pages 130 and 131. It says, in August 1501, a royal provision authorized the enslavement of the so-called cannibals. These Indians were brought to Hispaniola as slaves. So from 1508 to 1509, 400 Carib Indians were taken from the Lucayan Islands during slave raids from Diego de Nuquesa and Alonso de Ojeda. But this was only the beginning. So the raids into the Lucayan Islands, the Bahamas, started around 1508 and 1509, but that was predicated on a royal order. So there were wars going on right after that second trip from Columbus that lasted from that second trip all the way up to 1508, 1509. Here's from a source, the early Spanish main that I read from earlier, from Carl Sawyer. He says that the Spanish may have carried away as many as 40,000 Lucayans by 1513. Carl Sawyer described Ponce de Leon's 1513 expedition, in which he discovered Florida, as simply an expedition of slave hunting beyond the empty islands. So by 1513, he noticed that the islands of the Bahamas were already emptying out. But let's go directly into another source that I touched on earlier, Old Panama. I'm in page 51. It says, such were the timid, innocent aborigines of the Bahamas, living in an Eden-like simplicity and happiness in their island homes. 20 years later, when the Spaniards had terminated nearly all the natives of Hispaniola, they stole away the Lucayans to the number of 40,000 to slave in the mines on the plantations of Hispaniola. 40,000 Lucayans migrating into Hispaniola would have had a major impact in the culture and population of the island. But let's be clear, they were not new to the island because the king of the island at the time was Lucayan himself. So first they came willingly into the island, now they're coming forcefully. Either way, had to have had a major impact in the genetics, culture, and population of the island. What did this information mean for Dominicans with ancestry from the island? This is very important in terms of what is the early history, the true early history of the island, a Dominican Republic ethnic composition in 2014, and the vast majority, 70%, will be considered mixed. But mixed is not a real identity. As stated earlier, when Columbus himself was given a description of Lucayans, he gave a description that would kind of match what your average Dominican would look like today. The majority of the Dominican population would be classified the same way the Lucayans were first described, as having dark skin, but not European or African, not white or black, but brown or copper colored. Today in the Dominican Republic, this kind of skin tone will be called trigueño or indio. Why isn't this an understanding of how Dominicans choose to identify and call themselves? And not being product of some kind of white rape or European rape upon a dark-skinned people, but more so people who had these skin tones and phenotypes from the very beginning. So this must be understood in terms of knowing the history of the island and the history of the people. And one thing we cannot forget are the contributions of the Lucayans towards the foundation of America. If it has been documented who they were, proper credit must be given as the first cultivators of an important American crop, cotton and tobacco, that the Lucayans were already cultivating. They were the first to oppose the conquest, thus contributing to creating independent communities on the island. So you have to credit some of these folks as being your first Maroons. These are people who uphold their old religious and spiritual beliefs, and these are things that continue to this day. They're the upholders of the old matriarchal system in the Caribbean. So these are things that are still practiced today in the Caribbean, and we have to give proper credit where it's due. And we will continue to explore the early native population of Hispaniola as supplied by the Indians from the surrounding islands. So I hope you enjoyed this presentation. This was the Lucayans, Casualties of War. This is a continuing series on the other slavery of Hispaniola. This is your brother, David Rodriguez. Until next time, peace. This is the Hispaniola History Channel, La Historia de Hispaniola, presented by David Rodriguez. Visit AfroIndios.com.